नमस्ते बेटिया, माई सेल्फ जेवियर नेहा सैनी फ्रॉम फिजियोथेरेपी एंड डायग्नोस्टिक्स, ज्योति विद्या पीठ वुमेन्स यूनिवर्सिटी। हेयर आई एम गोइंग टू टेल यू अबाउट द एनाटमी ऑफ द फीमर। फीमर, इट इज़ अ लॉन्ग बोन, इट इज अ बोन ऑफ थाई। थाई इज द एरिया ऑफ द लोअर लिम बिटवीन द हिप जॉइंट एंड द नी जॉइंट। दैट इज़ व्हाट इट इज ऑल्सो नोन एज थाई बोन। सिंस इट इज़ अ लॉन्ग बोन, इट इज़ डिवाइडेड इन टू थ्री पार्ट्स, द प्रॉक्सिमल वन थर्ड, मिडल वन थर्ड एंड द लोअर वन थर्ड पार्ट्स। The proximal one third part is closer towards the cranial end of the body and distal one third towards the feet or caudal end of the body, and middle one third it is in the between the proximal and the distal parts. So this is the anterior and the posterior view of this bone. It is the longest bone of the human body. On the upper end, that is on the proximal one third part, we have this head which is articulating with the pelvis at the hip joint, which is a ball and socket type of joint. Then this is the neck of femur. It is the anterior view of the neck, lying between the head and the rest of the part of the femur. This is the greater trochanter. Here lies the attachment of the abductors, which can abduct the hip joint. This is the later posterior view of the greater trochanter. This is the lesser trochanter on the posterior side. Here we have the attachment of hip flexors. This is the intertrochanteric line, that is a line between the two trochanters, greater and the lesser trochanter. Intertrochanteric line lies on the anterior aspect of this bone and gives attachment to the capsule of the hip joint. This is the intertrochanteric crest. It is again lying between the trochanters, but it is lie on the posterior side of the bone. This is the fovea. It is a depression on the head of femur. It provides attachment to the ligamentum teres, and this attaches to the acetabulum of the pelvis and helps to stabilize the hip joint. Then this is the posterior view of the bone. Here we can see towards the greater trochanter there is a linear elevation. This is known as pectineal line. And if this continued upwards towards the greater trochanter, it becomes very rough and tuberous. This line is known as gluteal tuberosity. In the middle one third of the posterior surface of the femur, there is a very prominent line. This is known as linea aspera. This is the medial supracondylar line. Just above the medial condyle, we have this linear elevation again, which is up to the linea aspera. This is known as medial supracondylar line or ridge. This is the lateral supracondylar line. It is again found on the posterior surface of the femur. Here we can see this is a linear line starting from the lateral condyle up to the linea aspera. This is the lower end of the femur. Here we can see the two condyles of femur, that is the medial and the lateral condyle of femur. If the shaft is held perpendicular to the floor, the medial condyle is seen to project further inferiorly compared to the lateral condyle. So here we can see the massive part of the bone. This is the medial condyle and the other one is the lateral condyle. In the upright position, the shaft of the femur lies obliquely and the condyles appear to be aligned distally. So in the normal anatomical position, femur is not straight away. It is lying obliquely in our body. This is the medial and the lateral condyle. Massive one is the medial condyle. Because of this massiveness, the femur is lying obliquely in our body. Then above the medial condyle, we have this tubercle known as adductor tubercle. This gives attachment to the adductor magnus muscle. This is the medial epicondyle. Epicondyle means the most convex point of a condyle. So on the medial epicondyle lies on the medial condyle. On the posterior surface of the lower end of femur, we have this intercondylar area or intercondylar fossa between the two condyles. Now the muscle attachments of the femur. So on the tip of the greater trochanter, we have the attachment of piriformis muscle. This muscle is the key muscle of the gluteal region and it arises from the anterior surface of the sacrum. Then it is inserts on the tip of the greater trochanter of femur, as we can see in the image. Then this is the anterior surface of the greater trochanter. Here we have the insertion of gluteus minimus. Gluteus minimus, it is a muscle of the gluteal region. It arises from the hip bone and it is inserting on the anterior surface of the greater trochanter. Then this is the vastus lateralis. It is a muscle of the thigh, front of thigh, and it arises from the upper and the lateral part of the intertrochanteric line, as well as anterior in the lower border of the greater trochanter, as well as from the lateral part of the linea aspera, lateral supracondylar ridge and lateral intermuscular septum. So the muscle given in the diagram is the vastus lateralis. It is a muscle of the front of the thigh forming the lateral bulginess of the thigh. Then the muscles on the lesser trochanter are, it is iliacus and the psoas major. Both are the flexors of the hip joint. This is the iliacus muscle arising from the iliac fossa of the hip bone and inserts on the lesser trochanter. This is the psoas major muscle arising from the lumbar vertebrae, that is from the lower borders of the transverse process of L1 to L5 and the lateral aspects of the bodies of bodies and disc of T12 to L5. So this is the psoas major muscle inserting on the lesser trochanter. It is again a flexor of the hip joint. Then this is the vastus medialis. It is again a muscle of the front of thigh on the medial aspect. It arises from the lower aspect of the intertrochanteric line, which is highlighted in this diagram, and from the medial line of the linea aspera, then from the medial supra intermuscular septum. So this is the vastus intermedius. It is again a muscle of the front of thigh and it arises from the upper two-third part of the anterior surface of the femur. So on the major portion of the anterior surface of femur, we have the origin of vastus intermedius. So next muscle is obturator internus muscle. It arises from the inner surface of the obturator membrane and it is inserting on the medial surface of the greater trochanter, which is highlighted in this image. Then next muscle is the obturator externus. Externus means on the external surface. So this muscle arises from the external surface of the obturator membrane and it is inserting on the trochanteric fossa. Trochanteric fossa is a depression on the medial aspect of the greater trochanter, which is highlighted in this image. So here lies the insertion of obturator externus. Then this is the gluteus medius muscle. It arises from the gluteal surface of the hip bone and it is inserting on the lateral surface of the femur, greater trochanter of femur. Then we have quadratus femoris. It originates from the lateral border of the ischial tuberosity and it is inserting on the intertrochanteric crest. On the intertrochanteric crest, there is a tubercle known as quadrate tubercle. Here lies the insertion of quadratus femoris. It is quadrangular in shape, that is why it is known as quadratus. Then the next muscle is the gluteus maximus. It is inserting on the gluteal tuberosity. We have just read about the gluteal tuberosity. It is also known as third trochanter of femur. Gluteal tuberosity is also known as third trochanter of femur. Then this is the adductor magnus muscle. It is the largest muscle on the medial aspect of the thigh. It has two components, the hamstring and the adductor component. And here lies the insertion of adductor component of the adductor magnus. It is on the linea aspera. So here we can see on the linea aspera the insertion of the adductor magnus. And origin is from the hip bone. Then we have the adductor brevis. Brevis means small. Adductor means this muscle has the function of adduction of the thigh. That is why named as adductor brevis. It again originates from the hip bone and is inserting on the upper part of the linea aspera. So this is highlighted in the diagram. This is pectineus muscle. It is inserting on the pectineal line, just we have read on the lesser trochanter, originating from the hip bone. This is the pectineus muscle. Then this is the adductor longus muscle. It is inserting on the middle 1/3 of the linea aspera. It is again arising from the hip bone. Then we have the short head of biceps femoris. It originates from the linea aspera and the lateral supracondylar ridge. This is the short head of biceps femoris. Then we come to the lower end, that is the condyles. On the condyle, medial condyle, we have the origin of medial head of gastrocnemius muscle. This medial head unites with the lateral head of gastrocnemius and forms the Achilles tendon. This is the Achilles tendon. Then the lateral condyle gives attachment to the lateral head of gastrocnemius muscle. Here we can see the highlighted area is the origin of the lateral head of gastrocnemius. Then the plantaris muscle. It arises from the posterior aspect of the lateral condyle of femur just above the origin of lateral head of gastrocnemius and again inserts with the tendo Achilles on the calcaneum. Then the ligaments which are attached to the lower end of femur, they are lateral collateral ligament of the knee joint. It is attached on the lateral epicondyle of femur. Then on the medial epicondyle, we have attachment of medial collateral ligament of the knee joint. Then on the intercondylar area, we have the attachment of cruciate ligaments. The posterior cruciate ligament attached on the medial condyle, that is the lateral surface of the medial condyle. And on the medial surface of lateral condyle, we have the attachment of anterior cruciate ligament. So this is important. You must know the attachment of cruciate ligaments. Then come to the applied. It is the fracture of the neck of femur, which is very common. It is common in old age because of the spongy bone of the neck, which is atrophic and cortical bone is thinner. It is of three types, subcapital, cervical and basal. If there is fracture of the neck just close to the head, it is known as subcapital fracture. Over here, this is the subcapital fracture. Then at the midpoint of the neck, this is the cervical fracture. Then towards close to the shaft, this is the basal fracture of the neck of femur. So in case if the fracture is complete, it causes the interruption of the blood vessels which are passing through the retinocula to the head. If the vessels are interrupted, it will lead to avascular necrosis of the head of femur. So here we can see the vessels which are passing through the neck and they are supplying to the head of femur, and these vessels are cut, they are interrupted in the fracture, then this will result into avascular necrosis of the femur. If the fracture of the shaft of the femur occurs, then it will lead to the abduction of the proximal fragment, that is the proximal fragment of the femur will be abducted by the action of gluteus medius and minimus. It is laterally rotated by the gluteus maximus and it is flexed by the iliopsoas muscle. And the distal fragment of the femur will be pulled upward behind the proximal fragment of the hamstrings by the hamstrings and the quadriceps femoris. And it is also adducted and laterally rotated by the adductors like this. This is the fracture of the shaft of femur. The proximal segment is what? It is the upper segment, and this is the distal segment, the lower segment. Now the questions which are related to this topic are, write short note on attachments of upper end of femur. So in this we have to write about the attachments of head, trochanters, neck, intertrochanteric line and crest. Then second is avascular necrosis of head of femur. So just recently we have studied about the avascular necrosis because of the fracture of the neck of femur. So this you have to mention in this question. Then this is the exercise for you. You have to draw this diagram and label all the points which are highlighted in this image in your files. Use only
black pencil or black pen for outlining. There is no color for the bone. Then this is the second exercise for you. In this we have to discuss about the attachments of the femur. So draw this diagram and use appropriate color, that is for origin of the muscle use orange color, and for insertion of the muscle you use sky blue color, and label all the attachments of the femur. So this completes our topic, the anatomy of femur. Thank you.